Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Alamance County Commissioner Meeting. And before we begin, I'd like to lead us in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings you give us. Thank you for the opportunity for us to come out and voice our opinions with government. And thank you for helping us as a board to make the right decisions and leading our county forward. And just be with all these officers that have been shot over the last several weeks. And as the ones are out in the field, protect them and look over them. A lot of craziness going on, and we ask your blessing on them to protect them and just look after them and be with their families. These things we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's do the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
What's that? Same horse. All right. Before we get going here, public speakers. We'll start with Mr. Lash Reitenberry, top of the list here. And if you would, limit your speeches to 3 minutes, please.
10 minutes.
No, three, sir.
Good evening. The first thing I want to say, this is the only municipal meeting I have ever attended when the employees of the municipality are ushered to an overflow room. They are just as much citizens as anybody in this room. And I've said this before, and I'm tired of it. Now, I am a animal lover. We have 3 dogs, a cat, and 2, I wouldn't call them adopted feral cats, they adopted us. Plus my wife feeds a possum every night. So it won't tear up the dog food bag. So I love animals, but I think $5 million for an animal shelter is a little bit excessive. And I would suggest that they may go back to the drawing board and look at it and come in a little lower than that. But what I came here tonight for is for Terry Johnson. I stood up here back in June and asked you guys to give him some more deputies. He doesn't need anybody else in CSI. Doesn't need anybody in CID. He doesn't need any more administrators. He needs some road deputies. He has, what, 44 deputies. Burlington has 63 police officers that patrol. 63. They've got 76 officers. That's supervisors and patrol. Terry's guys are spread out so thin sometimes. If they need backup, they have guides with them. If you've never rode with them, you need to ride out in the county at night with these guys. My son's one. I know what. It's tough to watch him walk out that door, knowing sometimes that, you know, he may get into a situation he needs backup. They're not going to be there. That man right there would be there if he could get there. But Terry needs more deputies. And the thing that you need to work on the next budget, you need to give these guys and ladies more money. If we can transfer a man over the maintenance department to the landfill and give him a $9,000 a year raise, then we can certainly give a little deputy a raise. These guys don't make enough money. Let's look after Terry, give him more deputies, and give these men and women a raise.
Thank you, Lane. All right. Margaret Dameron.
He said what I was going to say.
He took your speech from you.
So I
did. Okay. Tony Cox.
Sheriff does need more deputies. He needs deputies or an investigation team to investigate corruption and fraud throughout government in Alamance County, to include the municipalities. That's my belief, because I see it. It's easy. Anybody don't see it, they just blind. Don't want to see it. But, you know, I took a person right over there to that building over there last week. That building right yonder for veteran services. And we went up that ramp over there, and that woman, she touched that rail over there, and she said, "Oh, it's so hot," where the sun beating down on it over there. So, I also met a guy that was there. He was an Iraq War veteran. He had to move down here from Chicago. He got shrapnel in the brain. Something happened to him in the brain for being over there fighting for our freedoms. And he had made a comment that wherever he had come from, it was up in the north somewhere, and I didn't get into it fully with him, but he said something to the effect of he had lost his severance or something with the fire department up there. That's pretty bad. But as long as government can use you, they'll use you up. And then when they can't use you no more, see you. But same way with us. But it's just amazing to me, but yet you're going to spend all that money on a doghouse. But I think there's better ways to do that doghouse over there. I think there's just as good a ways, and I think there's cheaper ways. We need a whole lot more than a doghouse, a fancy doghouse. But I know some of you have biases to the doghouses. Said it out loud here at the meeting. I don't know about coming in here with a bias, but either it's going to happen or it ain't. But we the people need help. We need to be able to get into these government buildings, these people in these wheelchairs. I don't know how much trouble. I've seen this man right here with this motorized one. He might be able to get around a little bit better with somebody that's trying to push him along or somebody trying to push them. I know it's tough because I've dealt with it. I don't mind it. But things could be easier for people to get in and out of these doors, out of these buildings, through these doors and stuff. But I guess there's a report on that too. And my question about that is, if there are violations, was there self-reporting to the state and the federal government on the American with Disabilities Act? I would like to know about that.
Thank you.
All right, Ron Namis.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
I don't know what the protocol is. This is my first time here.
We'll give you 3 minutes.
This is a real nice place you got here. I'm Ron. I live in L.A., Lower Alamance. And I have the pleasure of being in a charter member of the Citizens Academy. And I want to thank this gentleman. I don't know where the money came from. It was well spent. I recommend everybody take the course. A lot of people are here looking for money. So am I. But it would fit in my pocket. I understand years ago through research that there used to be funding for something called rainwater runoff gardens. And if you want to see rainwater runoff, please come and visit me, because I can show you what the results are living in the, how many people know where the Buckingham Mountains are? We live in the Buckingham Mountains, don't we, Sheriff? And see, nobody knows they're there. Water runs off everywhere. I got the DOT out to help with the problem in the ditches. But I literally need to build a rainwater runoff garden. I just had open heart surgery. I'm not going to dig the hole with a Mexican backhoe. I'm through with that. And I want to know if you can put funding back into that, or if the funding that you have, I think there's a group called Conservation Funds. If some of that is available, point me to the person if I can get a little bit of that. I can do some of the work, but I need something called riffraff. Do you know what it is?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Large rocks.
It's rocks about that big. A little bit, half the size of my head. And that's all I want, is a little help with it, and I want to know who to see. I'll speak with Mr. Bird after the meeting. He's going to get the money.
Actually, your Ag Extension Office would be able to help you with that. Agriculture Extension Office.
Mark Danley.
Well, I see him on a regular basis, and he's been out there two or three times, but he's never offered me any money or help.
I'm not sure there is money available, but if there is, he will be the person to ask.
They do conservation easement stuff.
I got him on speed. Thank you.
All right. Okay. You tell him we said call.
I'm trying to save Rock Creek, Jordan Lake, Hall River, and my backyard.
All right. Very good. All right. Any commissioner responses to what was said? Okay. Moving on. Can I get an approval of the agenda for the evening?
I move approval of the agenda.
Aye, sir.
All right. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposition. Thank you. On the consent agenda, are there any things on there that anybody would like to pull to discuss? Hearing none, then, can I get an approval to do the consent agenda?
So moved.
All right.
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right. First on our list tonight for business is a resolution for the animal shelter. And Mr. County Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Board. In front of you is a proposed resolution. This comes after months of discussions with our municipal partners, months of discussion with the City of Burlington, in trying to come up with a solution for our animal shelter. And it's something we know we have to do one way or the other, that there's issues out there that we have to address. The municipalities were not, they felt this was more of a county issue than it was a municipal issue, and at this point they have chosen not to participate within the capital project. So in trying to, right now we've been looking at preliminary budgets, and you know, we have no hard figures, but kind of the formula we came up with is the county would be responsible for 58% of the preliminary budget, and that was about $2.9 million. So in working with Paul's and also working with the City of Burlington, we kind of came up with an agreement, or a proposed agreement that we are recommending to the board for approval, is that we budget $2.9 million of county funding for the facility. Once the facility is built, anything above that is Paul's or the City of Burlington's. So we would be responsible for $2.9 million. If it was more than 5.2, this resolution says that that is our max, is $2.9 million. And we have this resolution. There's a couple of changes from the one that was in your agenda packet. We did add a number 6 and number 7. By approval of resolution, the chairman of the County Board of Commissioners is authorized to sign a contract with the City of Burlington based upon this resolution. In talking with their city manager and attorney, they would like a contract to be signed so that it is a binding agreement. And also, there was a lot of discussion about the operation of the facility and our contract that we do have with the municipalities in Burlington. And we wanted to clarify that, making sure that this was a separate deal. This had nothing to do with the operational. So all other agreements for operations for facility with the City of Burlington shall remain in full force and effect. So again, I appreciate the work of Paul's. I appreciate the work of the City of Burlington to get us to this point. I apologize that there's been some delay. But when you're trying to get multiple partners to try to agree, sometimes it's a difficult task. And I present this for your consideration.
Okay.
We do have members of the City of Burlington are here. Jess is here, the city manager is here, I think I saw, and also Sam Hunt with Paul's, I think, would like to say a few words as well.
Okay. Would you like to speak, Sam?
Well, the first thing I want to say is thank you for everything you do for the county. I think you all do a good job. You don't get thanked enough, so I always like to put that on the table first. I would like to recognize some of our board members who are here tonight. Lisa and Perry Nichols, Lane Williamson, Terry Crenshaw, my son Sam Hunt the Fourth. I think Dick Shirley was coming, but
He was. He's hiding out at the door.
Thanks. We got the car dealers. and of course, my favorite board member, Vicki Hunt, who was our chairman. And of course, you know, we've already heard about all the great things Terry Johnson's doing, but he has been a real good supporter of this and was on our study committee. Also, we have some people here that are very interested. You mentioned Harden Watkins, our city manager, and Rachel Kelly, but Pamela Notchley is the new director of the Humane Society, Renee Bardis, a member of the Friends of Mebbin Animals, and Stephanie and Jim Grantham of Sparkle Cat Rescue. So anyway, I know they share my feelings. I would say this about the amount. I know that Chairman Boswell and some of the commissioners and the county manager, y'all have heard and some concerns about the total cost.
Right.
And Commissioner Smith, I know he was kind enough to make the motion to approve it before, and he had some concerns about the cost. So as the county manager said, we had some delays trying to do this and that. But anyway, we did cut the amount back to $4.5 million, and that would be with the county share, the city share, and what Paul's would do. Of course, if necessary, Paul's is prepared to do a little bit extra, but I think once the bids come in, we'll really know then, and I think we're going to be fine. We're going to be what's needed, it's not going to be a lot of fluff. It's going to be what's needed, and we want to build it in a way that will last and serve the people for a long time. And of course, the city of Burlington has worked to pick an architect. They've got one picked. All we need is the final approval. They're going to pay the architect, which is a big thing in itself. So anyway, I thank you for all the help you've given us. And I would say this about Paul's, our fundraising is going well. We're at $514,000.
Wow.
So we feel very comfortable with our $750,000. And the schedule, as I understand it, is September this, you know, with approval of this, the city will hire the architect. They'll get the bids in May. Construction can begin in August. And then completion would be scheduled for October, November of 2018. So thank you. I think it's taken a little bit of time, but we've come up with a better plan. The cities are happy.
Right.
I hope Commissioner Smith is happy. And we're very happy. So anyway, thank you, and I hope you'll vote for the resolution. I'd be glad to answer any questions.
I have a couple of questions, and I do really support this concept and the way that this is unfolding, because it protects the county on our liability. But one question that I have for Craig and Susan, this would come out of our fund balance next year.
We're probably looking at 18-19. So we have budgeted $150,000 this year that we originally talked about. We would borrow the money, and that would have been our debt service. So we would probably budget a minimum of $150,000 over the next 2 years as well. So that would give us $450,000. And then probably at that time, we would use fund balance.
And so what I'm concerned about is what's going to be the impact on our fund balance. I mean, I know it might be $2.9 million or less, what you just said, but will our fund balance, I mean, we keep adding to the fund balance as we collect more tax revenue or decrease our expenses, and so are we kind of projecting that our fund balance won't decline after we do that?
Again, if we look at historical, we should be fine, and we should be growing fund balance again this year, and once our final audit is in. So
okay.
The good thing about this is it's good to spend fund balance, sometimes not on reoccurring.
Right, for capital. That's what it's for. It's more for capital, right?
That it's a one-time expense. So
right.
This is really a good thing to use fund balance for.
And I was doing a little bit of research, Mr. Hunt, on animal shelters. And when you came and presented before, you left us a brochure, and it was real small print on the drawing, but it seemed like there was the new construction would be something like 13,000 square feet. Is that about right? Do you know?
Well, I don't think we know precisely.
Okay. Yeah.
But it will be, they will use the current adoption center, and they will build sort of beside it.
Yeah.
I think the total was going to be something around 20,000, Vicki.
Yeah, I think so.
So I was just trying to get them, because what I was reading is that animal shelters cost, and this might be a few years old, from $200 to $250 per square feet, depending on the market and local conditions and all. But I guess the point I'm trying to make, when you multiply that out into the fact that we're limiting our obligation to $2.9 million, that's quite a good deal. I mean, it's kind of like maybe funding the most basic animal shelter that could be, and then everything else will be borne either by PAWS or the city of Burlington. So I mean, to me, this is a good reason that I can support this.
Well, thank you. Now, I would say this. There's been a lot of talk about fairness and what's fair and this and that, and look, when you have what 10 municipalities or something, that is a lot of opinions and all
right.
That, and that's fine, that's good, you want that. But our view is that the county is doing their fair share, and that what the city of Burlington is doing and what Paul's is doing is really making it a better
right.
situation. And so it's a win-win thing. I think the county's doing what's right, the city of Burlington's doing what's right, and the other cities, they have an operational commitment. And so I think all in all, it's really beyond fair, if you want to get right down to it.
Sam, let me ask you this. County is going to put up 2.9, and Paul's is going to put up 750,000, and you said that the total would be about 4.5. Where does the rest of the money come from?
The city of Burlington's putting up 920,000,
okay.
which was their share under the formula, and then they additionally are providing the land, so we don't have a land cost that helps,
right.
and then they're paying the architect, so that's another big
thing. And my understanding is operations will remain right. pretty much as they have been over
that's
the
my
past.
Understanding.
Yes.
I think that we're very fortunate in our county to have the city of Burlington and PAWS and the other municipalities supporting the operations for this animal shelter. Because in a lot of counties, it's totally the county's responsibility.
It is. I see Guilford.
Guilford doesn't have the best track record.
Yeah, right.
So,
and we don't want to go
to
that.
I think we got the best of everything in this county. We got
right.
the public and private and everything. And I commend you for everything. Thank you.
Well, Jess has done a great job at it. She's here.
She's here.
Any more questions for me?
No. Commissioners, anybody got any more comments?
Yeah, I'd like to say something.
Okay.
I'm probably like a lot of people when I first heard about this, is that the 5-2 number kind of floored me. I said, man, I can't imagine something that huge for an animal shelter. And so I'd never been to one, so I had no idea what it entailed. So I went out there with Ms. Hunt and took a tour of the shelter. the building they're in was built back in the 60s. That's a long time. Most things in the 60s are about ready to fall down, I think. But anyway, in my opinion, it was made. I can talk to that. But anyway, I thought it was a mess. I mean, it's really tough. And then when you think about it, the government's involved. And anytime you get government involved, things are going to cost more. And I had no idea that each cage had to have its own ventilation and all these kind of different things that you'd never think of. It has to have that. Damn it, sure, it's just got to be there. So, and then you have to have waste disposal, all kind of things that you just do not think about. And so looking at it that way, and then working the cost down to 4.2, and county, I think, is fair number with the 2.9, as he were talking about. And when you think about the fact that, and I'm not saying this building lasts 50 years like the other building, but you've got to plan for the future. You can't just build a building that's going to take care of this year. It's got to take care many years out. So although it may be a hard pill to swallow at times, thinking about the cost of this thing, we have no choice. Alamance County has got to do something because the government says you're going to do something. So this may be the best way to go, and for those kind of reasons, I support it.
I'm a lot like Roger, I think, because I feel like we have to build the animal center, and I have been shocked by the price, but having been in politics for a long time, I know that compromises are necessary, and I see all of the folks with their badges on here, and if any of you think I'm going to vote against it tonight, you're and I'm not running for
re-election. And we've got more outside.
They're waiting. All right, well, anybody else, Linda?
No, I'm good.
Well, I'm definitely in support of this. As Roger said, this is our responsibility, basically. Thank you, City of Burlington, for stepping up and helping us, because it could fall right back on the county, the whole thing, which Guilford has, and we don't want to end up like they are. So with that, I'll entertain a motion to approve the resolution.
I so move.
Okay, Roger, David, and Rob, Bob. Okay. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now you can get on with your process of getting that architect going. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I do want to thank Paul's, and I do want to thank Harden Watkins with the city, and also our municipal managers. And we've had a lot of discussion. I appreciate this board's support as well. I know it seems like it's been a long, drawn, slow now process, but I think we really worked hard to get to this point, and I do want to thank the City of Burlington for their leadership on this as well. Yeah. So thank you.
Very good. Thanks.
Yeah, we'll take our
yes. All right. Thanks so much.
There's some kind of legislative motion. I remember where you lay it on the table and you can't read.
What's Thomas want?
Yeah, we'll take a quick time out, Thomas. Need a break. Yes, Liz. Let's take kind of a 5-second break till they all get out.
I know. Me too.
I've been shocked today.
You better behave. Tell him to behave.
I've got some things down here. I ain't going to behave.
Do what? I'm here.
Yeah.
I support ACC.
I know.
You sure did enjoy it.
I love you. Thank you.
The reception, but the classes were awesome.
I'm going to keep my mouth shut.
That's your business. We can talk about $3 million now. Somebody will help me out of here. I saw that, yes.
I'll take you out with the sheriff.
Yeah. That's great.
I got a friend that comes in from Florida, and her and the sheriff have some kind of, I don't know how they got picked up with this stuff, you know. And so one time I was
leaving all right. Together. Very good. Okay, next on our agenda tonight is a request to set a public hearing for economic incentives. Mr. Mac Williams, we got him out of the back room there. Very good.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
I'm Mac Williams. I'm president of the Chamber of Commerce here for Alamance County. I'm here tonight to ask the commissioners to set a date for a public hearing for economic development incentives for a new project that's considering Alamance County. The date I would ask for you to set the hearing date would be Monday, October the 3rd, which for you is 9 o'clock in the morning. We would also be simultaneously more or less asking the city of Mebane to set a date for public hearings for them that same day at 6 o'clock in the evening. The policy that the Alamance County has is that at this time I'm required to disclose the name of the company that's involved, and I've got that bit of detail, and I would love to tell you so much more now,
but
I know it's an exciting project, trust me, and I'd love to get it all out there tonight.
Yeah.
But I'm going to withhold. We will have the advertisements for the public notices 10 days in advance of the Monday hearing, and then of course the Monday hearings themselves, where all the details and all the project specifics on the company project side and on the incentive side will all be disclosed as the process calls for.
So moved.
Give us the name.
Just the name of the company is Lotus Bakeries. That's Lotus Bakeries, and they're based out of Limbeck, Belgium.
Good grief!
I will leave it as requested and required. It's an exciting project. Hopefully, we can go through the state and the local processes as well as other things that have to be done and result in a nice new project for Alamance County. But first things first,
right.
Setting the date for the public hearing for Monday, October the 3rd at 9 o'clock here in this room.
Okay. I think we have a motion on the floor from Mr. Smith. Second. Thank you, Roger. All in favor of setting the public hearing for that meeting?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Very good, sir.
Thank you very much. We'll see you Monday, October the 3rd.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, next I guess our county manager is up with the health insurance recommendations.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and we do have Donna Dixon here with the Pierce Group who will make the presentation. One of the things that our board has asked and wanted us to begin looking at once we had a new broker was to rebid out our insurance and our carrier, so we have done that. I do appreciate Donna and the work that Pierce Group is done. I also want to thank our county staff that also reviewed and interviewed the applicant or the companies that came in. Donna had an incredible request for proposal. She narrowed it down. We had three companies come in, a very grueling interview process. All of them were really about the same, but we began really looking at service and since we're self-insured, how can we get better service back to our employees? And also I want to thank Judge Smith who met with Don as well as a representative of the insurance committee also. So with that said, I will turn after Don.
Great. Good. Thank you so much, Mr. Honeycutt. Thank you, Chairman and Commissioners, for having me here this evening. As Mr. Honeycutt mentioned, we did participate in a very extensive RFP process. And really what the main goal was to try to save the county some money, enhance some benefits for the employees, but also find a partner that was going to be able to take a real integrated approach to health and wellness for the employees here. It is no secret that healthcare costs continue to rise, and being a self-funded health program, it's really important that we put some things in place to try to limit those costs. So you may remember last year we worked on changing to a new partner for the prescription drug. And so this RFP really looked at trying to find a new partner for the administration of the health plan. And we did bring in three finalists that were all very, very close in price. But there was one leader that really took the front stage as far as their approach to managing the claims, and that is Cigna Healthcare. That is our recommendation for this next plan year. The plan design is going to be structured to really improve the employee experience and help the employees manage their costs. So today you have a grandfathered health plan that is based on a coinsurance model, which means every time an employee goes to the doctors, they're not quite sure how much that's going to cost. There's a deductible, then they're going to pay a share, the plan's going to pay a share until they meet their out-of-pocket. What we're going to do with this new plan is we're going to make it easier for employees to know what that's going to cost by adding some co-payments. So their primary care physicians, their specialist visits, they're going to know right up off the top exactly how much those are going to cost them. We're also going to have 100% preventive care included in those plans, and personal health solutions. And what those personal health solutions are going to do is going to help employees really navigate the healthcare system. We're going to be incorporating all of our partnerships. So as you're aware, we do have a partnership with Cone Health, Alamance Regional Medical Center, with their health clinic. They are going to be really coming to the table a little bit more with Cigna to really help educate the employees. That's a great resource that a lot of your employees are taking advantage of, but not as many as we would like to take advantage. And that is one of the most appropriate places for them to receive care. But sometimes folks need care that can't be provided there. This personal health solution is going to help those employees by showing them and telling them facility A costs this, facility B costs that, you know, which place would you like to go to help them manage their own costs, but also, of course, manage the costs for Alamance County. We'll also be enhancing the prescription drug program as well to include 100% coverage for ACA preventive medications, 100% coverage for smoking cessation treatments, and a lower cost mail delivery service. So we're very excited about those plan enhancements. We are also going to be enhancing the services that the employees receive. We'll have a dedicated phone line for Alamance County employees. That's going to be available to them during implementation and then after. And all of those calls will actually be serviced out of one location in the Tennessee office for Cigna Healthcare. So we wanted to be sure that everybody had access to great service 24/7. We are going to be recommending that the post-65 retiree plan actually remain with the partner that's in place right now, but we were able to negotiate a 27% cost reduction on that plan, and we're enhancing the prescription benefit in the donut hole period. So that's a Medicare approved plan, so we're going to be increasing that benefit for the retirees as well. We're looking at about a 7% decrease in the claim projection for the overall health plan, and we are still trying to be sure that we are funding that plan appropriately. So you'll remember back in July, you all made an adjustment to that health fund balance. I'm a huge advocate of always reinvesting in that. I think it's very important to create a fund balance that can sustain the highs and the lows of healthcare. And so we are recommending a increase to that fund balance by a slight amount for effective January 1st. And a small change to the dependent contributions as well to try to keep closer to market rates. Those funds, those rates really haven't been changed in probably more than 5 or 6 years, and we don't want those to kind of lose pace with the industry. So we will be recommending that for you all as well. Y'all have any questions?
I thought we just had an adjustment for family.
We had an adjustment in what the county contributes.
Right.
So we didn't have an adjustment in what the employee contributes.
Oh, okay. So what we're talking is an adjustment from the employee side.
Right. So we are looking at a pre-tax contribution of $75. So it would come out to about a little less than $50 per month for those dependents to be added to the plan.
Did I hear you say you're going to be doing away with the deductibles but adding the co-pays?
There still will be deductibles and co-insurance built in the plan,
mm-hmm.
But only about 20% of those folks that are on the plan would actually need to use those types of services that are going to apply to deductible and co-insurance. So 80% of your population is going to be really just rendering services that are going to now have a co-pay.
Will there be lower deductibles and co-insurance or co-pays if people use the Cone Health system, or are those the same?
They're going to be the same. They use the clinic, of course. There's
but
no charge
right.
for them to use the clinic.
And then the 7% reduction of projected costs
mm-hmm.
overall?
Right.
What's that dollar figure approximately if that came true?
I believe it's about $880,000. About $880,000.
Well, that's pretty significant.
It is.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the retiree plan's being reduced by about 27%, which is close to another $300,000.
So over $1 million we could expect to save under this new arrangement.
Well, that's expected claims.
Expected,
so, of
I
course,
understand.
Expected claims
sure.
continue to go up.
Right.
So
I understand about self-insurance.
That's not real money, but
yeah.
yes.
It's projected.
Yes.
is that $50 that you were talking about, potential increase, is that for a family, or is that for one person?
So each tier would see about a $50 deduction out of their paycheck. So if you have employee spouse or employee family, each one's going to increase by about $75, but it'll be pre-tax, so it'll be about a $50 increase.
So self plus one be $100?
No, it's a $50 increase over the current rate.
Right.
Oh, okay.
Yep, over the current rate.
We did have a lot of discussion about that, and as Donna said, we haven't made changes to the dependent or the family coverage in 5 years. While we have increased the county contribution for the individual over the last couple of years, we have not messed with the family part. So in order to make sure that again, we've had, if the board remembers, we have a low fund balance, we have some major claims. So we've been trying to do what we can to shore up this insurance fund.
Well, I like your idea of using our clinic that for the employees and
mm-hmm.
promoting health through that, because it's a great asset to our county. I know I use it.
Mm-hmm.
It's
mm-hmm.
very convenient and very good and low cost as far as to the county to use that.
It really is. I mean, that is a great, great investment.
Yeah.
And one thing that Don and the Pierce Group has done also, they've negotiated a $20,000 wellness benefit, so that they will put in $20,000 to a wellness program for our employees.
Yes, that's correct. Yes, so Cigna will be putting that in annually for us to use on programs with the employees.
Can any of that be used to incentivize people to exercise?
Well, you know, they have an entire health promotion team that will be working with the leadership here to kind of put the programs in place that hopefully will be the most appealing to the employees.
Like buy them a bike, maybe.
Yeah, like buy bicycles.
Silver Snicker award, right?
Maybe we could just give them a dog from the shelter and they could take them out for
there
a walk.
You go, there you go. Put them on the walk the dog
yes.
program. Yes. David, thank you for your contributions to helping out with this, and I know you're very familiar with it, so do you have some input?
I wanted to tell you, my colleagues here, that I had to meet with Donna and the manager separately from everybody else because she talked so fast, it's hard for me to understand. And it would have taken 3 days for the whole committee
to get
through.
To it. Very good.
She's done a great job, and
good.
I'm really
yeah.
pleased with the results.
Good.
And then for the employees, let me tell you, this is one benefit that most people in this county don't have.
Right.
So, and we have a great company leading us now, and I'm very pleased with it. Very pleased to be leaving the county with Donna and her group.
Very good.
And I'll make the motion.
All right. Thank you, sir. We'll take that. I hear a second to the motion. All right. Well, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Thank you, Donna.
Thanks, Sean.
All right. Next up is our fine sheriff.
Start off with, I put a copy of this police to population ratio by state on each one of you. And the main reason I did that is I researched, and there's several studies that have been done on police staffing. Some goes as high as 2.7, some go as low as 1.5. So what I did, I tried to find the staffing average for the state of North Carolina, which if you'll turn to the second page on your, yes ma'am, that right there, you will see that the average in North Carolina is 2.4. I took two other states that had similar populations to North Carolina, which you see in pink, and they were higher, 2.6 and 2.7. And what I want you to understand, the factors that go into a study involving staffing includes geographical location, the miles in a city, the calls for service. A ton of data has to go in and has been done on a lot of these studies. And what I try to do is find an average here in the state of North Carolina that we can compare for this presentation. So as we go, if you have any questions, please ask. I know Commissioner Byrd sent me an email today, and I tried to respond back to him, and because I know that it takes money to do these things. But let's get started. Okay, history of calls for service and staffing. Daily, our patrol vehicles respond to a variety of calls. These calls range from routine, such as citizens wishing to speak to an officer, to complex, such as breaking and entering in progress, and active domestic violence, and also homicides. And here lately, it appears that we're getting more serious calls in Alamance County than what we have in my previous experience as sheriff. Our response time to calls are sometimes is not obviously not critical, while at other times it can prevent injury and property damage and even death. Give you an example. Approximately 2 weeks ago, our patrol deputies were patrolling and actually caught a home invasion right after it occurred before the call come in. But had that not happened, there'd have been cars responding from all over the county, because that's a very serious situation where they'd beat a man pretty severely. And you know, as sheriff, my duty is to provide protection to our citizens and their property. My goal is to continuously evaluate and reduce response time to calls for service. The quicker we can respond to a call, the greater chance of the apprehension of the individual that has committed the crime. Now, we have four patrol platoons. When fully staffed, and a little bit of, and the thing shows 40 or 10 officers on a patrol, we have four patrol platoons. We have moved some people around right now because of the call volume, where we have an extra person right now, but they need to go back to their previous duties because we're getting high behind there. So when fully staffed, a patrol platoon would consist of three supervisors, lieutenant, sergeant, corporal, and eight deputies. But we've had to move some people around to make that happen currently. Each platoon works a 12-hour shift, 6 a.m., 6 p.m., 6 p.m., 6 a.m. However, it is rarely, the shift is rarely full simply because of injury, vacation, sick leave, mandatory in-service training, and overtime. When you don't have enough officers on the street, there's been several times that, say, a home invasion occurs at 5 o'clock in the morning, that shift has to stay over till 8 or 9 or 10 or 11 o'clock because the other shift is answering calls, which cause you to have to either pay time and a half or give time and a half off. Well, guess what that does? When you don't have enough people, guess what? you're going to wind up working people more and more. Right now we have six districts in the county. Our county is very large in territory to cover. And a lot of times the county is segmented in six districts, one deputy assigned to each district. Now let me tell you something. When you have a bad situation, a hostage situation, a home invasion, and everybody else is tied up and you have to respond to that call by yourself, the chance of that officer getting hurt or having to hurt someone is great. If an officer is on an extended call, an adjoining district car, or an all district car, if available, will move into and take calls in that area. But because of the number of officers we have on a shift, that's not possible. Friday night, Saturday night, you would not believe it. Come and ride with our officers and you will see. During the week, holidays, tremendous, tremendous. Civil division is responsible for serving civil process throughout the county, including all municipalities. That means that some of our sworn officers, that I'll go over in just a little bit, is not able to respond to calls, which you'll see in a minute. Office is also responsible for service of all domestic violence order, again, including municipalities. We have to go in the city and serve these orders, and a lot of times the officers inside the city and having to respond to things at the far end of the county. History of call volumes updated. Numbers have been updated from a previous budget request, which I appeared before y'all at our budget session this year, and was given to deputies. I asked for five, given to, and we had to put those in the tech division and pull them out and put them elsewhere to help out some on the calls. And all calls were served. Previously, routine calls and traffic stops were extracted. Below is a more accurate accounting for officers' time. If you will look, July the 1st, 2014 to June 3rd, 2015, we answered 40,568 calls for service. From July the 1st of 2015 to June 30, 2016, 60,837 calls. You see the increase there. Now, with these calls comes a lot of arrest of individuals violating the law. Guess what? That officer has to appear in court. And many times he will sit all day long, the case not be attended to in the court, and he has to come back again. Well, guess what? That's time and a half that that officer has to have off. Therefore, means your shift is going to be short an officer at certain times. Already, from July 1st, 2016 to August 31st, we've answered 10,586 calls for service. Warrant service. July 1st, 2014 to June 30, 2015, we served 3,685 warrants. July 1st, 2015 to June 30, 2016, already 4,064 warrants. And let me tell you something, folks. When a person has a warrant out for them, many of them choose to hide, run, and not answer doors, which means you're making trips after trips, and many times it takes four or five deputies to respond to that warrant service to be able to cover the back door or the front door to get these individuals in custody. And it's a very dangerous situation in a lot of warrant service. Okay, from July 1st, 2016 to August 31st, 2016, we've already served 728 warrants. Civil processes. You see the year of July 1st, 2014 and June 30, 2015, we served 11,494 civil papers. July 1st, 2015 to June 30, 2016, 11,609 civil papers. Already this year for 2 months, we have served 2,013 civil papers. Also, people don't like to be served with civil papers, so they don't come to the door or they don't respond to the note on the door, and eventually you have to catch them somewhere else to serve these papers. Okay. According to the Bureau of Justice Standards, the common practice staffing standard for the number of officers per 1,000 population 2.7. That's one of the studies that was done. A study several years ago that was done was 1.8, I think it was. The average among North Carolina agencies is 2.4, and that is the staffing level that I have used in this request. Our service population extracting the county municipalities is approaching 70,000 people. Utilizing above standard, Alamance County should have just short of 168 sworn officers. Currently, we only have 125 sworn officers, and here you see, which 40 are assigned to the patrol division. We have brought four over patrol division right now because of the problems we're having in responding to calls that will go back if I'm able to get some officers tonight. Okay, comparison, local comparison here. Burlington Police Department population, we took the, got it through the census, 2015 census. This is what they say, 52,472. Per 1,000, 2.4, using the same factors that I used for the Alamance County. They have, and I got these from the Chiefs of Police, they have 129 sworn officers. The state average should be at 2.4, should be 126, so is they three above. Yes, sir.
That's taking the population times 2.4.
That's correct.
The last column.
That's correct. Last column is 2.4 times population. That's what the state average is.
And the sworn column is the actual.
Is what the chiefs told me were sworn positions in their departments. Okay. Graham, 2.4 at 14,647 sworn. 37, and the state average is 35, so they're two above what the state average would be, which I'm sure they need it with what's going on now in our society. Mebane, they have 31 officers sworn off according to the chief, when the state average they should have 33. Mebane is a very big growing area right now also. Elon Campus PD, the PD and the college officers total 35. Their state average should be at 2.424. Yeah, so
that population of Elon doesn't include the student population, though, does it?
No, not when the students come in. Yeah. No, when the students come in, they probably need the 35. When students come in, they're not there. You're right. Okay, Alamance County, subtracting all those, is 69,846 population. 2.4 officers per 1,000. We should have state average 168. We only have 125. However, what happens even with our 125, we have six officers assigned to civil division. Their first shift serving civil papers. We have eight are school resource officers, which we will take out of that equation because they work the schools and sometimes if they're getting off, they can answer a call. But very seldom. The problem is the sheriff has to cover the courtroom. Currently we are 10 are courtroom bailiffs. Now, if we had that courthouse shut down, the courthouse here shut down, and everything in one building, guess what? We could say 10, 12, 15 officers. Because some judges come in here and say, I want three bailiffs in my courtroom. Plus we have to do the security downstairs of checking people coming in. And in the old courthouse here, that's usually five officers just there. Downstairs here, two officers plus two or three in the courtroom, judges won't. Then we go over to the other courthouse where there's two or three courts sometime going, and if you have two or three officers in that courtroom, we have to bring people off the street to put in those courtrooms, which takes people off street and requiring us to hustle more to answer these calls. We also have animal control officers, and we did not put this up, but I have three people that are sworn officers that do nothing but transport inmates to and from prison. So if you look at the entire problem here that we're facing, other agents do not have these responsibilities except SRO. By taking the above numbers minus the SRO position, our total of sworn officers would be 108, 60 less than the state average. So what I'm asking tonight, and yes, sir.
Right, question. These numbers here, those add up to 25, and the 6 and the 8 and the 10 and the 1, and then you said 28. You have 40 on patrol?
Yeah, we have.
Well, that doesn't add up to 125, so you have a lot of others.
Okay, what we did, now, these are what I did here. We're just showing assignments to these people that are not out on patrol, are not able to respond, right. But we have a total of 125 sworn positions.
But on a previous slide, you said that you only had 40 that were assigned to patrol.
Assigned patrol. Actually, we've moved some of these people.
So maybe 44.
Right, 40 to 44 out there.
But if you had 44 to the 25 there, that's only
65
yeah. or something. Yeah, so
you lost me here.
Well,
you lost us there.
You have more staff than what that yeah. slide and the previous slide shows. I was just curious
anyway.
What those other staff are.
Okay.
Are you looking for the people that work in the jail too? They're
We have sworn people in.
But the jail, the detention center staff aren't part of the 125.
No. Yes, it is. We have three transportation officers in the jail plus a investigator, gang investigator, that is the people that are coming in that is not listed up there.
Okay.
It's not listed up there.
You must have a lot of others that aren't listed there.
They are, son.
Yeah, okay.
Yes, sir. But I was using these to point out where our positions are a lot different than a city municipal
agency. Well, I understand that.
Yes. And that's basically it. What I'm asking tonight for some help. I know Alamance County cannot put up no 50, 60, 30, 20 officers. But we have got to have some help because we're going to start losing the people we have. And the times in our society is getting more violent. And I'm going to tell you one thing. I do not want to lose a police officer because we did not have the proper number of people on the street. That is a fear of mine. Secondly, I don't want to lose no citizen because we could not respond in time. Yes, ma'am.
Give me an application.
Let me ask you this.
Yes, sir.
Give me the figures the city of Burlington has of troopers actually patrolling. What?
They have 60-some actually patrolling. Is that
cars?
63.
I knew it was 60-some.
63 patrolling. They have 13 supervisors.
My supervisor patrolling.
Five lieutenants and 8 sergeants.
And how many do you have?
But with Lieutenant Sergeant everything, 44 by moving 4 people from other positions right now.
Well, it bothers me that the cities, and I think the other municipalities are pretty close, the cities have a lot more protection than our citizens living out in the county as far as law enforcement is concerned. And this board, I think the county's been remiss in this for a long time. And I'm as guilty as any of them, but this man is here asking for more, and I think he has a good reason for it. I just don't think City of Burlington, where I live, they should be protected more than the people who live in Snow Camp or Altamaha, Ossipee area. I just don't think they should. And about.
I was going to say, we're paying for it in our tax rates.
I understand that, but it doesn't
right.
keep enough people on the ground to protect our people. If we can spend almost $3 million on an animal control center that is protecting and helping protect dogs and cats, come on, there's something wrong and we can't hire more deputies, and I'm going to make a motion that we give the sheriff 10 new deputies tonight.
Give me my application.
Well, what is being requested? Is it 4?
Well, let me tell you something. We got to get patrol division. We have 4 platoons. I have got to. We've got to have 4. We need more.
How much per deputy does it cost the county?
Well, if you're talking about salary, about 40.
Salary and everything.
$45,000 per deputy salary and benefits.
So you're talking 10 deputies, that's $450,000, right? Now, if we can't find that and we found $2.9 million for an animal shelter, there's something wrong somewhere, and I'm sorry, but...
I kind of agree what you're saying, but the animal shelter's a one-time charge. It's not a recurring thing. The $400K is every year.
We're also talking about animals and human beings.
Oh, I'm not disagreeing with you on that.
So I'm strongly in favor of the animal shelter, always have been, but I'm also in favor of protecting our people out here who live. That one picture he showed of the length of Alamance County.
That is...
If you have two patrolmen or two deputies up there in the northern part and they have a serious thing, that one right there, have a serious thing down in Snow Camp, just trying to get down there, look in the middle at all of that congestion there they've got to try to get through.
Well, y'all seen the chase, I think, in the budget time, the chase where that was because of having to fly because the officer was hollering for help. And like I say, tonight I will take anything that you give me. You know, we got to have four on patrol so I can put those others back. We've got to have them.
Well, I'd like to say that in my almost 2 years of being a county commissioner, I've gotten to know the sheriff pretty well, and I really respect your judgment, and I really don't believe that you think that you're asking for something that you don't really think is necessary.
I would be up.
And now, say you got the 10, which Dave is talking about. How do you put them out in cars, and how do you? I mean.
I explained to the county manager, whatever we get, I will buy the equipment out of federal drug seize monies that we were given after the DOJ decided to leave me alone.
Well, one thing, I mean, I really don't like to do mid-budget
alterations
unless it's really necessary. Yeah. I mean, we go through a budget process for a reason, and that's just good management. And another thing is that I wish we had a resource in the county like an industrial engineer. Roger, I don't know if you used industrial engineers where you work, but they are great at helping department heads to
figure out
analyze processes and figuring out, well, is this what the staffing level you really need is, and to analyze comparative data to make sure we're comparing apples to apples. And and I just wish we kind of had that resource. And
that'd
be nice.
I'm going to do something. Gail Miller there, town of Swepsonville, she's just itching
just
to
like
say
something. I'd just like to reiterate with you, sir, just today, I'm Gail Miller. I'm on the town council of Swepsonville in the southern part of the county, and I've spent time with Officer Shelton Brown today asking for increased coverage in our Swepsonville area because of the park we have and the Quarry Hills now. We are having a much more problem there, and I just requested more coverage today. I would like for you to consider that.
I appreciate that input, Gail. Thank you. But, you know, because you mentioned response times, and where I used to work, we would actually, well, what are the response times? How are they trended? What's kind of an upper limit? Mm-hmm. And that's what an industrial engineer would help to analyze.
You're right. Oh, that would definitely.
And
a whole lot of factors.
And you mentioned, it would probably reduce overtime, I guess, and that would help pay for these positions, too. It'd be nice to know what those numbers actually are. But that's a lot of analysis that... I don't know that we have the time to do before.
Well,
we
on this shorthand. I said and tried to figure and look, but right now, and this is something to think about. You're looking at response time of about between, I'd say, 30 and 40 minutes. Now, what I looked at, that is way too. When I first come in, we had response time down to 7 minutes. Okay, not only is that response time increased, but also. Every report you have to take, you figure an average of about 40 minutes of taking a handwritten report from the individual. Then you got to get back in your car and do it on a computer to get it to the office. And what's happened, calls are coming in so often, officers are not being able to fill out their reports. They have to stay after shift to do that. And many times after a 12-hour shift, I'm going to tell you folks something, you want to go home and go to bed.
That's right.
You know. And there's mistakes, you know, you make mistakes, the tired you get. That worries me a little bit about our officers out on the road offside.
Well, with 10 new deputies, you're not going to have to hit the budget for all 10 at one time because it's going to take a while to get
staff
new ones trained and come in, and you're going to basically be staggering the influx of new deputies coming in.
Well, you know, I think for now, I'm a little uncomfortable with going 10, and I'd rather do the four that's being requested, and we'll take another look and see how that goes. But, you know, it's tough balancing. I mean, there are needs, and then there's the affordability of being able to fund those needs. And we're going to talk about our strategic plan in a little bit, and one of the five pillars is public safety. And so that's an important thing to consider, and maybe we build into that plan some goals and objectives that include staffing and maybe other measures.
Yeah. Put triggers in it where based on population and population goes up, your head count.
We've talked about automobile. One of the best things was the 12 cars a year. We're able to do that. You know, whatever you do, if you don't give it tonight, the four or any, we need to look at a strategic plan down the road to make sure that if the board changes, is those ideologies going to change about how you're going to keep up with our population?
And we do have to keep
and up with it. And it's real important. I'm telling you, folks, we're in a critical situation here.
I was talking about Mebane a while ago. When I moved to Mebane, there's about 5,000 people now. It's probably 17 or somewhere around there. Does Mebane's growing impact you a lot?
It sure does. They're calling for help. We have to send our CSI units a lot of times down there to help do crime scenes for them, and a lot of their stuff comes over into the county. A lot of chases comes over into the county. Just you know, it's unbelievable. We also assist Graham, Hall River, any of these departments that they call on Gibsonville, what our calls for assistance, we try to help them. And many times it takes us a while to get there.
Yeah, I appreciate Bob's position. I do understand it. But to me, this is an emergency. And the county's got to be able to move faster when we have problems like this coming up. Strategic plan, that's fine. We've had one for 16 years. And it just seems to put things off into the future even more. And wait, let's get another study. And let's bring in somebody here to tell us what's best. The man right here knows what's best for this county as far as law enforcement is concerned, and I'm willing to put my money behind him, and I don't think we need anybody else telling us exactly what we do need. You're going to come up with the same result 2-3 years from now. I know I'm not going to be here. I understand that. But
well, I wasn't suggesting any further studies on that or anything.
Oh, I
industrial engineer on staff that can help us with that. But,
well, I was just getting to the strategic plan, which is coming up later.
Okay, well, we have a motion on the floor from Mr. Smith. Did I hear a second to that?
I'll second it.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
No. Okay. The motion was for 10.
For 10?
10.
I'm not in favor of 10 at this time. I could support 4.
I think Ty's got that. And you fill those positions as you go with it.
Do I now?
Yes, you got the 10.
Don't come in here asking for any more.
Hey. Let me say this to the commissioners. The equipment I will buy from federal drug seize monies. I know that, you know, the economic situation in this county, and I appreciate the 10. I talked to our county manager for 4, tried to put them on there, and I assure you, I won't be back for a while. But I would love for y'all to eventually look at the staffing, not only for the Alamance County Sheriff's Office, but the other divisions within this county.
Well, I just feel like we just gave you the sleeves out of our vest, because giving you 10 head count, I don't know how soon it'll take you to fill 10 head count.
Well,
it might be next year before you fill those 10 head count.
That may be a problem, because I'm going to be honest with you.
So 4 or 10.
We're having a problem getting applicants because of the national trend toward law enforcement. So we're not just going to hire anybody.
I know.
That's what I'm saying. You get to try to get the best and the brightest to do the job, and it takes a while.
Yeah.
And what we'll do with respect to the budget is we'll use lap salaries at this point. We'll create the positions, but we'll probably, once we get closer to year end, we'll come back and do a budget amendment of where we feel like we're going to have salary needs.
Out of that.
Well, Sheriff, I just want you to know, I don't want you to think, take my no vote as a lack of support of you or your department.
Commissioner Burt, I understand each one of you are very concerned about the economic situation in this county. And I respect that, and I want you to understand that does not bother me one bit. I come before you asking for help, and if y'all have said no, I'd have went right back and sat down and would have still tried to do our best with the sheriff's office. If you'd have given me 4, I'd have been happy. If you give me 5, I'd have been happy. But I can tell you this, there's going to be a whole lot more cases solved and more people going to jail.
Well, you have a long county to cover, and I
understand
that. It is big.
435 square miles is a...
If we save one patrolman's life, it's worth...
Well, I tell you, it's been my fear for the last several months, that because we got a lot of young officers. And with what the DOJ has did... There, some of them I know is afraid to follow their training because somebody will file a complaint on them, you know. And I've told my officers, you do your job, I'll worry about what happens afterwards, you just go home safe.
Well, 6 years ago, I wouldn't have voted for that, but you read the newspaper every day.
Oh, yeah.
And you see where our law enforcement
is. No, I understand. But I promise you this, we will use whatever money I can use out of federal drug asset monies to, and we'll get the equipment. Secondly, we have put in an application for a grant for 2 officers through the COPS program to put out in Green Level. If we get that and we haven't hired everybody, I assure you we won't. Okay?
Thanks for all the work that you did in preparing for this and the information you provided me today.
Yeah, well,
that was really
thank
helpful.
You. And the question you had today was absolutely great. When I went through all the research, calling people and stuff, there's been so many studies that use different factors, and best I could do is look at the national, or I mean the state average, and that's what I did.
Thank you.
Thank y'all very much.
Yes, sir. All right, very good. ACC bonds. Susan is coming up here.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you this evening is the adoption of our capital project ordinance for the Applied Technology Center at ACC. This will appropriate the $16 million that we had through the bond sale. $13.4 million of that will be for construction, $2.4 for site development cost, and $100,000 for bond issuance, which brings the total project to $16,067,761.74.
Okay. So moved.
Well, I'd like you to explain that bond premium. Why?
I will.
Why we got that extra million?
I'll be glad to.
Million.
The board did approve for us to go out for a $15 million bond, and when the bids came in, it was a very competitive sale. And to help win that bid, a lot of the investment companies will throw out a premium, which says we want to buy your $15 million bonds, but we also want to give you money in the aspect of that as well. So the individual who bought our bonds was through SunTrust Robinson Investment, and they put up $1,067,761.74 to be added to that project in addition to the low interest cost that we got for the 20-year bond.
And that was due to our fund balance, is that correct?
So we just pay back $15 million
plus the interest. We only pay back the $15 million.
A very good interest rate at that.
Yes.
Exactly.
Which is low because of our good fund balance.
That's right. Through our bond
we'll
rate.
We'll keep working on that.
Yes.
All right. Very good. We have a motion
on the floor. I'll second the motion.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Very good. And Dr. Gatewood, I didn't even recognize you. I'm sorry about that.
Thank
you very much. You got approved, so. Thank you all for coming tonight. Okay. Let me flip on over here. Lease agreement for cardiac monitors. And Ray, our EMS director.
Everybody has met Ray, haven't they?
I have, a couple times.
I have.
Yeah, okay, I just want to... I can't remember. Have you presented before?
No, sir.
This is his honorary night.
This is his initial night, and
And again, let me introduce Ray Ripperman, our new EMS director. And Ray's been on 2 months, 3 months?
3 months.
3 months. And Ray comes to us from Brunswick County and has done an exceptional job being here. We are thrilled to death to have him. We thank you for the job that you're doing. And Billy, who filled in wonderfully as the interim, is here as well. And Billy's taking on a new role as really Ray's assistant, and we appreciate Billy doing that as well.
I thought they were a tag team.
Just want to recognize Ray for being here as well, and thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Honeycutt. And thank you, Mr. Chairman and Board of Commissioners. We come before you tonight requesting approval to enter into a 4-year lease with Physio Control to purchase new cardiac monitors, / defibrillators. These will be LifePak 15 monitors, which will put in the hands of the paramedics some of the cutting edge of technology as far as diagnostics and treatments. And they will replace our current cardiac monitors, which are LifePak 12s, some of which were purchased as far back ago as 2001. And these monitors have reached end of life. Service is becoming more difficult. Part acquisition is becoming more difficult. So this lease will really allow us to increase our level of service, increase our level of care that we provide to the citizens of Alamance County.
And this is a budgeted item?
Yes, this is a budgeted item.
So move.
So I have a couple of questions, if I could, please. So the list price of this is over $1.1 million, but we're going to get some discounts, contract discounts, and then some trade-in discounts.
Yes, sir.
Like, so the final bottom line is $835,000?
Yes, sir. And in that $835,000, that includes $36,000 annual cost for service. So the equipment is somewhere around $620,000. Okay. And then that service, the first year of service is actually covered under warranty, but you pay ahead for each year of service.
Sure,
so in the fifth year, there'll be no service costs, but we'll be fully covered.
So why are we deciding to lease instead of just outright purchase them?
That was the recommendation from management and finance.
Yeah. To spread it over the course of the 4 years versus a one-time payment of almost $1 million.
Right.
So it was put into the 16-17 budget to purchase it through a lease agreement.
Through a lease. Do you know what the imputed interest rate is on that lease?
It's actually around 1.9%.
So that's very low.
Yeah. Very
okay.
low.
All right.
Very, very low.
Okay.
All right. We have a motion. Do I have any more comments on that?
I'll second it.
Bob, thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Ray.
All right,
welcome
thank
to
you.
Alamance County.
Thank you.
All right. And next up, we have Libby with our strategic plan I'm sorry.
ADA
compliant. Sitting right there. I got to go down the order there. Robert Keith, sir.
Do want to introduce Robert. And as board members, we had some discussion at our last meeting about some issues with ADA. And we had a internal staff look at it. I appreciate what Robert's done. Brian also served on that committee. Buddy Weitzel, who is our maintenance director, served on the committee. And what we did is we took initial looks. And again, we didn't want to look at all county facilities, really where our public congregate. And we wanted to make sure that we were meeting those requirements. And if there were issues that needed to be addressed and fixed, we wanted to do that as well. And again, I appreciate Robert Key and all his work and input in getting this report ready.
Is this what Tony's been complaining about?
This is what, and he left.
Yes.
Maybe he'll read about it tomorrow.
Okay. Well, the discussion kind of came up too when we were talking about the facility due contract.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. First of all, thank you all for your service to the county. But to be fair, we started a committee to do this last fall. It was Brian, Buddy, Richard Hill, myself, and Scott from the state Rhodes, yes. We started looking into it, and what the federal requirement is not so much geared towards buildings as it is services. So, but that having been said, you can't provide services until you can get the people into the building. So we did take a look at all of the main, not every single facility the county has, but all of the heavily used public facilities that we have. And so we did an assessment on them based on the ADA requirements. The good news is a lot has already been done. Buddy has a list of what's been already accomplished through capital improvements and things that have just been happening through the years. But we, from this report, have a pretty clear picture of where we are and what the current needs are and areas where we do need to improve to come up to the standard. It's not just that it's a Department of Justice mandate, that's important, but it's also in line with our values as a county, the golden rule, be nice. We don't want to deny services to someone who has a disability, that would not be being nice. So having said that, we've looked at the facilities and we've identified a list of what we might call low-hanging fruit, things that are not terribly difficult or expensive that will make our facilities more compliant. If you have the report that we did, those items are highlighted in yellow. If you don't have a copy of that, it was electronically included in the agenda, but if you want a copy of it, I have some here. But we would like to go ahead and look at doing the things as soon as possible that are easy to do, and then come up with a longer term plan for things that are more difficult. Some of the more difficult aspects are street parking. Because an ADA parking space has to be pretty much dead level, pretty flat, and that's hard to do with the way that streets are designed so that water will run off. The other factor is that, for example, for this building, the ramps and entry to the building are all very compliant. The street parking is a weak area, but again, we have to work with Graham because we're not in control of changing those parking spaces. So that's kind of all I have.
Could I ask a question about the ramp to this building? Because Mr. Cox was observing somebody really struggling on that ramp when he spoke to us about this. And when I went out and looked at the ramp, I noticed that the sidewalk is on a slope too. And I know that there are standards about what the slope has to be ADA, 1 inch per foot. And so when you measure that, are you measuring it compared to a sloping, and also a sloping sidewalk, or is it you're actually using a level to determine?
We actually used a digital level to assess all of the surfaces, and the ramp that leads into this building absolutely meets the code. Okay. It can't have very much side slope to it. Anything greater than 5%, you have to have basically handrails on both sides to help people get up. Our door approach is good. There are some things that are things that we would like to do that are not mandated. For example, the push-button door openers are great. I know Susan would very much like to have one of those, and they are nice to have. They are not actually mandated by the Department of Justice, but they're very useful. Mm-hmm. Anyone else have any questions?
So are we being asked to approve something tonight?
No, this is right.
We're just giving you a report on what we've done.
And what the reason why we want to bring it to you is there's really no self-reporting that we have to do. I think what the Fed really look at is there a group of county employees that is looking at the issue, that is addressing issues of noncompliance, and if we have complaints, is there a process for complaints? So what we've decided, at least among staff, is we're going to address all the low-hanging fruit that we can. And there are some major things we would like to look at, such as Robert said, the push button at Human Services. It's not required, but it would be a nice thing to do. So we may be looking at that as part of our CIP, as far as our buildings. But again, we have a process. If we're going to put this online, and I appreciate the work Robert's done on this, we're going to put a process online if there's a complaint so that we can address it. We're not 100% compliant. However, what most people like to see is our plan to move towards 100% compliant. And also, if there's complaints, are you addressing the complaints so the citizens can get their services? So right now, we have not had any, other than the comments that were made in public input, we have not had any citizen complaints with respect to being not able to get in due to disability. So
one of the reasons I was very much in favor of going ahead with the facility dude proposal was because they were going to assess the quality of the buildings overall, because we might have some of our 40 buildings that we have may not be worthy of investing a lot of money in to comply with some of these ADA requirements. And I'm afraid that, you know, I mean, that's one of the, it would help to ensure that we're not putting good money after bad is essentially.
That is certainly an important thing to take into consideration.
Yeah.
Since we have a lot of very old buildings.
Yeah, looking at your list, these are not real large money expenditures, moving signs, doing right. You know, minimal stuff. But
the highlighted items are not going to be terribly expensive to do. When you get to regrading parking lots and things, you know, that does get into some more money. But again, a lot of the buildings already are very good, just they're not 100%, but they're very close. HSC, for example, needs compliant restrooms, really, because it doesn't have them. But the path from the 88 parking spaces into the building is 100% compliant as it is right now. So we're not open to any really accusation of being negligent on that particular building.
And that's one of the things we've really taken into consideration, especially if we look at the youth services building. When we renovated the youth services building, we knew that the bathrooms were not compliant. Now we have two very good, compliant ADA bathrooms in our facilities. So when we do upgrades to facilities, those are the things we take into consideration when we design and construct anything. So that is a forefront of what we try to accomplish as well.
Well, and a number of these are addressing the municipalities, such as Graham and Burlington, I noticed, with some issues, you know, getting up sidewalks to where the building is and those kind of things.
I think the county ought to be a leader and really set the example of really assisting people with disabilities. I mean, they have enough problems as it is with their disabilities. We don't need to be adding more constraints to their lives.
Yeah.
I often say that because we deal with accessibility from a different, it's Title III for what we deal with, but people will complain about having to make facilities accessible, and I always remind them, you know, you or I could be in a wheelchair by the time the day is over. So that's would right. You like to also, on top of that, be denied services?
But I think one of the best part about this is, again, I appreciate Robert and Brian and Buddy and Richard starting this committee. This has really given traction to that committee to move forward and to make sure we are continually improving the ADA requirements for our facilities.
Very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank
you.
Appreciate Buddy it. And Brian for their work, too. Okay. Strategic plan. Now, Libby, it's your turn.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm going to try to be as brief as possible. I know we've already been here a while. Try not to be too dry when I go over all the stuff. So I'm here to present an update to the strategic plan. Just to give you a very, very brief history, we've been working on this for a year. At the direction of the Board of Commissioners, we began this process in September of last year. So as part of that process, we've reviewed Destination 2020, we've done 17 public input sessions, we've done a number of retreats, had department head meetings, lots of stuff kind of behind the scenes has been going on. I want to thank everybody who's been involved. I could not have gotten to this point alone. We've tried to reach out to the public just as much as possible. The second thing I'd like to say before I kind of get into the meat and bones of what we're going to be asking for tonight is that the strategic plan as it stands right now is meant just to be the framework. You know, these are just the bones that we're going to build the rest of the plan on. It's also meant to be a living document. So that means that as the county changes and grows, this plan, we would like it to change and grow as well. A continuing part of this plan is that we need to keep checking in and checking up on what it is that we have in this plan to make sure that it does reflect what we've heard from the public, because that has been our goal all along, is to get feedback from the public. Current budget, we're $5,000 under what we were given, and we thank you for that consideration. when we started the project as well. So our request today, and all of a sudden I'm starting to lose my voice, so I apologize. Our request today is for you guys to adopt a vision, which is where we want to be, and which describes where we want to be in the future. The mission, which is how we go about putting that vision into place. Our five pillars, which is what we're calling our five main themes that developed out of all this public input. Our core values, which we developed as a way for us to be clear about what it is you should expect from us and what we should expect from ourselves.
Us being county staff.
Yes.
Yes, the county government.
Yes, yes. County government in general. And finally, I would really appreciate it, and I'm sure the people who have put the names in would appreciate you choosing a name for the plan as well. So as part of our process, this vision statement was developed. The finishing touches were put on the June 29th retreat. This vision is Alamance County is a cohesive community with a thriving economy that balances respect for our rural history with thoughtful growth and development. Our mission statement, Alamance County effectively provides its citizens with high quality public services, the tools for successful economic development, and a responsive, transparent government that supports the community as the preferred place to live, work, and play. So I tried to put all these together into one sheet within your agenda so that it's easy to kind of keep up and read. I'm reading them out here for those of us that don't have the full agenda printed. So for our five pillars, and they're in no particular order, they're all very important. So I think it's important to point that out as well, that stature on the list doesn't necessarily mean that that's the most important, because we all have, you know, our competing interests. First pillar is preserving agriculture, a vibrant, protected rural economy, supporting locally owned and operated farms. World-class education is a commitment to world-class education to encourage a prosperous community and individual success from cradle to career. Smart growth and development, planned growth that strikes a balance between a thriving economy and an appreciation of natural and agricultural resources. Public health and safety, which our sheriff was talking about earlier, develop and implement activities that provide for the well-being of all citizens in a responsive, respectful, and engaged manner. And government accountability and resource management, which is our commitment to provide leadership through innovative and effective management, and to promote trust by providing transparency, openness, and appreciating citizen concerns. As part of this process, we realized that we really needed a statement about our core values and what it is we hold important as employees and as management. From those, we came up with these five. We're sticking on the fives for some reason. But it's respect. I'll let you guys read it. Respect, honesty, accountability, the golden rule, and commitment. So finally, at the beginning of the process, we collected names from the community forum participants as part of the process. We thought it would be fun to do something a little more fun instead of the dry kind of data crunching that staff ended up doing on this. But it was organized by the Alamance County Library System, so thank you to MJ and her staff for all the help that they've given me with that. And 16 names were chosen and submitted. We also took it to the Planning Board, which all of these items have been vetted through the Planning Board as well. So these were the names that remain. There's a second single sheet within your agenda that actually has these names listed as well. So tonight, for our next steps, like I was talking about, that the five pillars are just the bones. So what we're planning to do from here is we're going to organize committees of internal and external stakeholders. Stakeholder is a fancy word for folks that care about particular items. We'll come up with these committees so we can come up with particular goals and objectives to really flesh out the plan, put the meat on the bones, have some things we can track. we'll integrate each pillar into our performance management goals. Like I said, something we can count and track a little bit better. And if you guys choose the name tonight, then we'll be working on integrating that into the plan and creating some new publications with that information on it as well. And that's all I have. In a nutshell.
And what are you asking us to do?
Approve
these pillars?
Yes, sir.
And the mission and the vision.
Mission and the vision and the core
values. Being heavily involved in this, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the vision, the mission, and the pillars and the values. And then we can come back later and vote on the name.
And I'll second that, sir.
What under these pillars, you said this is skeleton. Where is the meat?
Well, that's what we're talking about. The next step would be to, I'm sorry.
Well, I was going to just offer that. Well, you were going to say, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but the next steps would be to have a committee to meet, as you explained, to come up with some actual goals and
action
steps.
And with those different steps.
And will that come before the board?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Yes. And in my strategic planning experience, I mean, I think Libby and her staff and all the people that she's worked with did a wonderful job at distilling the many, many issues that came up at these planning forums. I attended quite a few. I know, Eddie, you did too. And we had people in the audience, Dorothy and Gail, and other people attended these. We had county staff actually facilitate many of those forums. But to distill that all down into five topic areas for goals, I think, are really good.
And these were the cream that rose out of
these. Yeah,
these
are the ones that really rose up, had lots
good.
Of repetition coming out of these community forums, that these were important areas. But just as an example of how this could transpire, take world-class education. Well, you know, a big part of our county's budget deals with education. We've got a lot of activity going on in the community around the community engagement to support education. And knowing that the education of our society, starting with preschool, I mean, starting after a child's first born, the impact that that education will have on our future and the prosperity of the county, people that are get through high school and do something post-secondary, utilize public services so much less, it's just really important. So now we decided this is important for the county to move in that direction around education. Well, there are lots of county services that touch
the
kids.
The safety issue,
and
too.
Safety, yeah. The sheriff's got SRO officers, and the health department is making sure these kids are healthy, and our DSS touch kids. And so now they can be more focused in their plans and in their budgets on how they might be able to support this pillar of world-class education. And, I mean, agriculture is so is important, and public health and safety. I mean, all these are just really important. That so then we'll get more specific. I don't know how you did it at IBM, Roger. You know, you have these major goal areas, and then you get specific on action plans or action steps and actual specific objectives around all these areas, which staff will
right. And one thing we've done with the strategic plan has kind of been the shotgun approach. So now we're kind of narrowing it down to the rifle. So we know the areas that now we want to work on. So we've kind of compressed everything to these five pillars. And then again, we will bring back any action plans or any budgetary
for
items that will affect
boards,
that the Board of Commissioners will have to approve.
Yeah, I think this plan is quite a bit different than the 2020. The 2020 focused a lot on land use, that type thing. These are things that our community is involved in, other than just how they build houses and this, that, and the other. So I think it's been a good process. I think the people have enjoyed being part of it too, ones I've talked to.
Yeah, I like the safety part. Like for Sheriff Johnson today, instead of every once in a while he comes in here with a cup, you know, trying to get a head can in a cup, you put something together where you know he can,
where are you going?
He knows where he's going
right.
Over you.
Yeah.
And that'll be good having it.
And one way to use this plan, especially with respect back to these pillars, is that when things come before us as a body, this should be in front, this should be part of our agenda packet, this page here. And when something comes before us, we should ask ourselves, is that request consistent with our mission and our vision and with our major goal areas here, our pillars, in the plan itself?
Yeah.
Much like I was on chairman of the planning board over in Mebane, and we had a growth Mebane strategic plan. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what we did. Yeah. Is when people wanted to come in and locate different businesses or whatever in an area, we just go to the map and say, nope, that mm-hmm. doesn't comply the deal. So we need it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to adopt the county vision, mission, and the pillars tonight. Is that correct, sir?
Well, for this motion, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. All right, and we've got a motion. I second that. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay, very good.
And then I'd make a motion. Could you put
the names
back up there?
Yeah.
I see Robbie's sitting out here. He's on the planning board. With all due respect to the... I kind of like the first place result there of the second poll, the Vision Alamance. That'd be my favorite, but I'd be interested to see what other people have to say.
You making a motion?
Well, I'll make it a motion.
Second.
All right. Okay. So we chose which one now?
Vision Alamance.
Vision Alamance. Okay. Sorry, planning board members. Okay. We got a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. That carries.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Libby. Good job.
Got what you needed there. All right. Okay. County manager, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One of the things that we would like to ask, and we don't have the actual figures, we have an guesstimation at this point, is the $500 bonus under our performance management program. We would like to ask if the board is willing that we bring this for approval and cut checks in October instead of in November. And the reasoning for that is, in talking with payroll, they have a lot of paychecks being cut with the Board of Elections with respect to all the part-time help that they have. It is a constant issue with our part-time people and making sure that those poll workers get paid. So we will bring you a budget amendment at the next meeting, but we want us to go ahead and start work on it now. That will be for a distribution in October. It's approximately $408,000that's been allocated from, that would be allocated from performance budgeting to the bonus.
So this is in our fund balance already to pay?
This is in the performance fund balance, yes.
In the performance fund balance?
Right.
How much are you losing interest when you pull it out a month early?
We have not pulled it out yet, but not that much. But it really just more of an accounting issue as far we have one payroll clerk. We're in the process of changing over to Munis and changing over to Cronus with payroll. So the quicker we can get that out, the better. So we just wanted to ask your blessing on that. And we will bring you the budget amendment in October.
So we
Sheriff Deputies.
So do we need to move this forward?
If there's a consensus to bring you the motion, we just want to make sure that's okay first.
Any comments to that?
Is the sheriff deputies included?
Yes.
That?
Yes.
Okay. Very good.
All right. We'll bring you back the budget amendment at the October meeting.
Okay. And our next one is a budget amendment for the library. And our librarian. What's she doing? She's locked out.
You didn't hear anything.
Oh well, let's move on to the next thing. Sorry. We just went on by you, MJ.
You're gonna be raring to go now, locked up in a room
here.
I'm
telling you.
We were awarded an LSTA grant, which is a Library Services and Technology Act grant from federal funds. And when we applied, we thought we were only getting $29,150 from the grant, but we were actually awarded $32,142. So, $32,142. So, and that's a difference of $2,992, and we just needed to have a budget amendment to have that added in, and I've designated the line items that will be, that amount will be added to.
I'm going to beat David. So moved.
Second.
Thanks. All in favor?
Aye. Thank you.
Thank you, man.
All right.
Was that worth being locked up for?
It's always worth being locked up to be fit before.
Okay. We're not going to be that easy on you.
Well, there's nothing like coming at the end of the meeting after you've spent all the money. This actually, unfortunately, usually I come with my own money, but we had an unfunded mandate passed in the General Assembly that came out of the blue. The Commissioners Association didn't see it coming. We didn't see it coming. But they allotted an additional $34 per person in a facility, in a family care facility, per month, and you pay for 50%. We didn't have that in our budget. So for Alamance County, we have about 450 recipients of what's called special assistance. It's a form of Medicaid that pays for family care homes and assisted livings. So at 30, you have to pay 50%, so they allotted $34 from to begin October 1 through June 30th. And for us, that's about $67,000 for our 450 recipients. Now, one thing you need to remember is it's an entitlement, so anybody who signs up and qualifies for special assistance to pay for a family care home, it has to be approved. So that number can vary, but right now we're anticipating about $67,000 in county dollars to make the 50% match for this bill passed in the General Assembly. It wow. was.
So this is additional money going to the.
Going directly to the family care home. Mm-hmm. $34 per month.
How much do they get now?
It varies, but on average, about $1,100 a month.
So $34 is a daily rate?
No, this is just an extra $34.
Per month?
Per month.
Per month.
Per
okay. And it's mandated
per
by
month.
Legislation.
It's mandated by legislation. They're going to draft our account at the end of each month starting October 1. So on the last day of October, we'll be drafted for our 50% of $34 per recipient.
I was like, this is something we need to get involved with our
legislators.
Yeah, with our County Commissioners Association.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, put that on the legislative agenda.
And how did this pass by the association?
Well, yeah. It was tacked on to something at the end.
Oh,
and
man,
so we didn't anticipate
that.
It, so we didn't budget for it at DSS. So we're seeking an appropriation
we
from
really
fund balance.
We don't have
balance.
Much choice.
Yeah, where will this funds come from?
Fund balance.
So right. Tell me again, is that $68K a month?
No, sir. $67,000.
One time, $68K.
One time for the year.
Between okay. October 1 and June 30th, yeah. We're anticipating
for the
cost
rest.
To
okay.
be
$67,000.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Drafted our account. There's not.
So we don't really hardly have to vote on it.
You know, it used to be.
You have to put it in my line.
This is a Medicaid program expense, right?
Well, it's special assistance.
Special
it's not
assistance.
Called Medicaid. It's special assistance. It is so it pays for the facility, the family care home, whereas Medicaid pays at the nursing home
right.
level. So it's similar, but the eligibility requirements are lower than Medicaid. So less people are eligible only if you're in a family care home or an assisted living.
Mm. I think we need to talk to our representatives and our state senators.
I'll be glad to put together some talking points and the law
be,
for
I think
you
it
and
would
get
be
that
a good
to you. I'll be glad to do
for
that.
For next year anyhow.
Yes, sir.
It sounds like it's a done deal.
It is for this year. The one interesting part of the law says until the funding runs out, June 30th or until the funding runs out, and they're referring to the state funding. So as long as their state funding is there, we have to make the match. But if they run out before June 30th, then we won't have to pay either. So.
And then the assisted living facilities will be without that little increase.
Well, that's exactly right.
Okay.
I'll put together some talking points for you.
I guess we do need to.
So move.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Second.
Roger. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
All right.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
That's crazy stuff. Budget amendment for finance.
I'll be doing this one. This is a reimbursement from the city of Mebane and Alamance County back to the city of Graham for Project Porter, which is really the Walmart and Lidl. This cost of road, there was some grading costs, engineering costs, and our portion of that is $284,839.26. And that is a cost that Graham will have, and also a cost that Mebane will have. So this is our third, or this is our share of the total.
So was this budgeted, anticipated?
It's anticipated, but we anticipate to take it from the fund balance. We're hitting fund balance.
Yeah.
So this is a one-time thing.
This is a one-time thing. Yes, sir.
So move.
Thank you, David. I'll second that. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All right, very good. School capital project fund finance.
The last item.
You're fast. You got
that I have tonight. Before you, commissioners, is a budget amendment to move $1.5 million from general fund to the school's capital project fund. This is where we have collected sales tax revenue in excess of the debt service payments for fiscal year 15-16.
So move.
Thank you, David.
I'll second it.
Thank you, Bob. All in favor?
Will it establish a new bottom line funding for the year? And like next year, when you create the funding for the schools, will it be that number plus X percent?
This will be just for their capital projects, not their current expense and their regular capital.
But I mean, does it change the percentage on that sales tax they get?
It does not. Where that comes into effect is when the sales tax revenue is collected, we have different articles. And these portions of the articles are set aside to cover school construction and debt service payments. So when we look at how much debt service we're paying for the year, and it's something that we have to reconcile after the close of the fiscal year, is we look at how much was collected versus how much was paid. And as their debt goes down, then that would cause that to go up. But that's also in relation to sales tax collected. So if we see a change in our economy, then that does affect that number, as it has in recent years.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
And does the Treasury Department kind of oversee these numbers, or who does that?
Actually, the Department of Revenue is the ones that collect all the sales tax, and then they submit that to the counties, and there's a two-month lag on that. So when we collected sales tax in September, that was actually our first payment for the fiscal year in July. So they give it back to us, and it is broken down by article. So then we compare it to what our debt service payments are and then allocate it accordingly.
So the Department of Revenue is breaking that down?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
All right, we have a motion and a second on that. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
All right, very good. County manager report.
Very quickly, one of the things I did want to mention is if the board is aware, on behalf of Golden Leaf, there was a community-based grants initiative that the county was kind of the funnel for a $1.5 million projects, worth of projects. We received one project that was from ABSS and also from ACC. It was kind of a joint project to do a STEM program at Graham High School. So we will be submitting to Golden Leaf this grant application. There was only one received. So I think at one time I told you I thought there'd be multiple projects. We may have to recommend one or two, but we only got one project in. So I'll be sending that letter to Golden Leaf this time next week.
Okay.
So STEM is science, technology,
engineering,
and math. So they're gonna create four additional classrooms at Graham High School. Do wanna mention our SOAR breakfast, if you would like to have that on your calendar. Our quarterly employee recognition breakfast will be Friday, September 30th. at 8:30 a.m. at the Family Justice Center. And also wanted to mention very quickly, County Government 101, we had 12 people show up. I appreciated Commissioner Parker showing up as well. We had a really good presentation from Jeremy Aiken. Susan did a great job. We have another meeting tomorrow at Graham Library, which will be done, Board of Elections, Library, and Veterans Services. So that is going really well and very excited. So, and again, appreciate staff's willingness to be a part of County Government 101. And that's all I got.
Very good. I did notice where Board of Elections sent an email out today with they have early voting
yes,
sites.
Yes, I think also there was a article in the paper. Okay. I think Anna's already put one, or at least she tweeted it.
Will it be on our website too?
Yes, okay. It's already
there. I say that Kathy Holland came to the Senior Democrats meeting last week. She was invited to come and just to explain some of the election processes. She did an excellent job.
She really does.
Yeah. All right. Commissioner comments? Y'all done talked out tonight.
I've said enough.
I'll take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Thank you. And a second? Thank you, David. All in favor, get up.
Judge, you didn't beat her to the punch.
Commissioners Board are on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is at 9 a.m. and the second meeting of the month is at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on Time Warner's Public Access Channel on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month at 10 p.m. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information about watching meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions regarding the content of commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can send mail correspondence to the commissioners by sending it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.